1993. It brought us a changing world, and at times it seemed the United States was struggling to define its role in it. Breakthrough in the Middle East, turmoil in Russia, conflict in Somalia and Bosnia, storm warnings over Korea. In this country, violence made us ask tough questions about why we are the way we are, made us wonder sometimes if our society was tearing itself apart. But for our starting point, we choose January 20th, the day Mr. Clinton began his watch.
Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States.
So help me God.
So help me God.
The man from hope takes charge.
We have heard the trumpets. We have changed the guard.
But the trumpets are quickly drowned out by a series of bent and broken campaign promises, an embarrassing search for an attorney general, a messy attempt to lift the ban on gays in the military, and in February,
to middle-class Americans who have paid a great deal for the last 12 years and from whom I ask a contribution tonight.
The damage is done. With spring comes crisis overseas. Bosnia.
As a Jew, I think that we must do something to stop the bloodshed in that country.
Finally, the last superpower says enough.
I think the time has come for the United States and Europe to look honestly at where we are and what our options are.
But the reluctant European allies greet the president's plan with the diplomatic equivalent of, we'll see, and it quietly dies. And Bosnia suffers on. Summer brings crisis at home. Americans with guns leave a trail of terror in places we once considered safe. Violent crime turns the state of Florida into a state of fear. Ask Americans what troubles them most in 1993, and crime is the answer.
It's showtime.
Showtime and showdown over the Clinton economic plan.
Take this lead pencil and give him lead poisoning. Kill him. Right through.
After a narrow victory in the House, a dramatic all-nighter in the Senate.
The Senate being equally divided, the Vice President votes yes, and the conference report on the President's economic plan is passed.
What we heard tonight at the other end of Pennsylvania Avenue was the sound of gridlock breaking.
Mr. Arafat, Yitzhak Rabin, the President of the United States.
September, the unimaginable, right before your eyes. After a century of killing and revenge, the Israelis and the Palestinians fall into each other's arms like exhausted prize fighters.
We say to you today, in a loud and a clear voice, enough of blood and tears. Enough!
September also reminds us the Russian bear has yet to be fully tamed. Hardliners try to turn back the hands of time. Yeltsin regains control with the barrel of a gun. Mr. Clinton cannot dwell on problems overseas for long. The nation's ailing healthcare system is waiting for a presidential prescription and a presidential challenge.
Before this Congress finishes its work next year, you will pass and I will sign legislation to guarantee the security to every citizen of this country.
October, and the U.S. mission in Somalia turns from mercy to madness.
Our mission in Somalia is over. It's time to come home.
The dilemma for the president, coming home with honor.
Our mission from this day forward is to increase our strength, do our job, bring our soldiers out, and bring them home.
November, the year's last big fight.
We're going to have to compete and win. I think we can do it. This is a big boat.
NAFTA. Mr. Clinton confronts rebels in his own camp.
Stop this NAFTA now!
And of course,
do you guys ever do anything but propaganda?
Isn't it your business?
Did you even know the truth of yourself?
With Republican help, he gets a badly needed victory.
Tonight's vote is a defining moment
for our nation.
And perhaps a defining moment for a turbulent first year of the Clinton era.
And we turn to Robert Novak, Chicago Sun-Times syndicated columnist and a panelist on CNN's Capital Gang. Sir, your headline of the year.
Gridlock is broken. Taxes go sky high.
Michael Kinsley, senior editor of The New Republic and co-host of Crossfire, your headline.
Goodwill toward men. Oh, I got it wrong. Peace breaks out in Middle East. Goodwill toward men still uncertain.
Over to Mona Charen.
1993 was the year of on-the-job training for President Bill Clinton.
Mona, syndicated columnist and a panelist on CNN's Capital Gang. Mark Shields, you share those titles. Your headline of the year.
Bernie, my headline is Crime, Fear of Crime, Grips America, Changes a Nation.
When we return, the first year mistakes, triumphs, and style of the Clinton presidency.
The debate continues. Washington is hearing from lots of special interest groups. They're hearing from doctors and hospitals. They're hearing from the drug companies and the insurance companies. But one special interest group has more at stake than any other. Our nation's families. At AARP, we believe that no family should have to worry about losing vital health coverage, and that all families should be protected against the costs of prescription drugs and long-term care. We need health care reform. Let's get it right.
Here's something you should know.
You can use dividend reinvestment plans to invest directly in companies and bypass brokers entirely.
Now, available under one cover, every company that accepts optional cash investments and everything you need to get started investing. All for only $9. Plus, you get a free copy of The Money Paper, the monthly guide for the self-reliant investor.
It's easy to buy stock without using a stockbroker.
Call now to get the Guide to Dividend Reinvestment Plans and find out more about The Money Paper.
Right now, powerful forces are shaping television's future, and it could change your life in every way. On January 2nd, CNN presents A Look into the Future, TV 2000.
It was a year of conflict, change, unrest, and unprecedented opportunities for peace. CNN Special Reports looks back on the events that define 1993. The Year in Review, New Year's Eve, 10 Eastern on CNN.
Mark Shields, William Jefferson Clinton's first year in office.
For the first time in 12 years, we have accountability. And that is the most enormous change, and I think the most encouraging. If things go well, Bill Clinton and his party prosper politically, as does the nation. If they don't, then there's somebody to be held accountable. For 12 years, we've had no accountability.
Mona, what say you?
Well, I hope Mark is right, because if there is accountability, then the Clintons and the Democrats who control the Senate and the House are going to pay a heavy price. It was not a good year for government in this country.
Robert?
It was an old Democrat year, breaking the gridlock, high taxes, not much cut in spending. In fact, spending's going up, more regulation. But the disappointing thing was really that the foreign policy leadership was worse than might have been expected.
Michael. You know, Bob carries on about high taxes already. That seems like a ludicrous fuss last summer. The only tax that the middle class people are paying is a higher gas tax. Gasoline prices are lower than they were before Clinton became president. I think it was a very successful year and will be seen to be that in the future.
What do you see as the highest of the high and the lowest of the low for this new president?
We're probably in the lowest of the low now, because the stories that had circulated during the campaign were not really pursued have now come back to haunt this administration, and have really cast a shadow over some of the late year successes, such as the passing of NAFTA.
I don't think that that story has legs unless something comes out, which has certainly not come out so far, and which there's no evidence that ever will come out, that Clinton was misbehaving in some way during the election campaign or since he became president, or since he was elected president. There's no evidence of that whatsoever.
The phone calls to the state troopers.
The phone calls are entirely
from the White
innocent.
House. Well,
Mona, if someone
that's
heard,
quite credulous of you, Michael. I mean, what
someone,
do you think
you
the president
heard,
was
you
saying?
Heard, I'll tell you. If you heard that someone was spreading scurrilous, inaccurate stories about you, let's assume for a moment they were inaccurate, and wouldn't you, an old friend of yours, someone who'd worked with you for years, wouldn't you pick up the phone and say, what the heck are you up to? I don't see anything suspicious about that at all.
Can I say something right here? There's an interesting little paradox here, that all the Democratic politicians that I talk to think that the stories and the reports of the president's activities are absolutely true. They say it doesn't make any difference, he's doing the right thing. The only people, and this is really odd, who I have heard say they are not true are journalists. And that just kind of the world turned upside down.
Journalists say they don't have evidence, and journalists tend to rely on evidence except when they're so biased they can't control themselves.
I don't think it's that. I don't think that the journalists in the Los Angeles Times were biased. I think the journalists who say that there was no evidence are the people who are so committed to his fortune that they are going to say that we cannot even believe the testimony of these state troopers.
I couldn't
Mark,
disagree.
You're looking awfully pensive.
Well, I couldn't disagree more wholeheartedly, my friend Bob. I mean, there is a stronger and more pre-existing American principle here, which is anybody is innocent until proved guilty, and that even goes for presidents of the United States. Bernie, for 12 years we went through sort of a professional wrestling arrangement in Washington. That was a conservative president submitted an unbalanced budget to a liberal Congress. Liberal Congress criticized the president for doing it, said he was a spendthrift, then basically passed the budget. For passing the budget, the liberal Congress was then condemned by the conservative president and his friends and supporters in the media and politically. All right, we had a built-in system where the national debt quadrupled, and you said, whose fault is it? It's their fault, okay? Each side had a built-in scapegoat. We don't have any more scapegoats. Bill Clinton deserves credit for that. He's taken the responsibility, he sought the responsibility, and the Democrats, surprisingly enough, having been a congressional party for 25 years, have become a presidential party. They may, Mona's right, they may pay dearly in 1994. I don't think they will, because I think their fortunes and the nation's fortunes are on a rise right now. But the reality is, that is good. People can look and say, somebody's in charge.
Mark, following what you're saying, what is to be said about this president's management style?
Well, this is, I think, a surprise to a lot of observers that Bill Clinton, though he was very familiar to Washington and familiar with Washington, got here and really conducted himself for the first 6-8 months of his presidency like a novice. He didn't understand basic things like how to control the agenda and how to make sure that his story is the story that leads the evening news. So that for the first 6-8 weeks of his presidency, we were all talking about his change, you know, his reversing his campaign promises and his gaze in the military posture.
Is there something he could have done, Mona, to get you to repeat his agenda rather than your own?
Absolutely. You know, when Ronald Reagan came to town, he began
you
to fulfill
followed, you
his
followed,
campaign
you
promises and control
Reagan's
his agenda.
Can I respond to what Mark said? Because I've heard him say before that he turned the Democrats into a presidential party. There were two great successes by the president in this Congress. The one was certainly a Democratic success, which he had a minority in his party was strongly opposed to what he did, only passed by one or two votes in each house.
With
and
no
that was
Republican
the tax
votes,
with no Republican
That's
vote.
Right.
And that was the tax
never happened before.
That was a tax increase. Mike, we won't know the impact of that until it really kicks in on the economy, not only April 15th, but in the months after that. So I think you're going to find a slow bleeding process. The other thing, Mark, where I disagree with you, is the other thing that he passed was NAFTA, which was very essential, I think, for the United States' role in the world. And that was not a Democratic victory. Majority of the Democrats were opposed to it. He got that with a Republican aid. So the idea with a Republican majority, so I would think that the idea of accountability is a little bit diluted.
Let me just respond to Bob briefly. The first reality is this, that the Democrats under Bill Clinton have voted more cohesively with greater unity than at any time in the past 40 years, any political party, and voting a tough, not voting to cut taxes, voting to impose taxes upon Bob and his country club friends.
Okay. Health care and the impact of Hillary Rodham Clinton when the year in review continues.
Hey, listen up. Everybody's heard of Kemper, but you might not have heard of Konica. There, now you have. What Kemper means to you, what Konica means to Kemper, why you trust Kemper, why Kemper trusts Konica. So if you know this company, you should know this company, because Konica answers the call for Kemper. Troop dismissed.
You can't breathe. You're sneezing. Your sinuses and nasal passages are blocked. Where do you go for help? Last time you went to your doctor for a prescription. This time he told you to get the same prescription strength medicine without a prescription. Tavis D, the antihistamine decongestant that was once the most prescribed by doctors, is now the most recommended by doctors for 12 hours of relief.
Good morning.
Tavis D, one tablet, 12 hours, no prescription.
On a recent morning, we surprised our newest millionaire.
Is he still $20
million? I won Publishers Clearing House.
They're here, the prize patrol. Hurry up, over.
You deserve it. Oh, my gosh.
Congratulations.
It was a day no one there will ever forget. We're the Publishers Clearing House Prize Patrol, and we're looking forward to seeing you soon.
It looks like you can get very rich very fast at American Family.
Eh? Right. These people won millions, Dick.
Sensational. Now, whose picture goes here?
That's reserved for the new $10 million winner.
Another one?
Could be you. This soon.
Noted wine critic Robert Parker recently called our Domaine St. Michel unquestionably the best bargain in American sparkling wines. This review pleased us so much, we almost went out and bought a bottle of Dom Perignon, Domaine St. Michel.
And we go to Michael Kinsley, the subject, healthcare, Hillary Rodham Clinton.
Bernie, there will in all probability be some kind of healthcare reform passed, if not next year, certainly by the end of this first term of Bill Clinton's administration. Even if the most radically conservative healthcare plan now on the table, say the one being proposed by the Heritage Foundation, were to pass, it would be the most important piece of social welfare legislation since the Great Society, at least possibly since the New Deal. And Bill Clinton will have deserved credit for having shifted the public attitude and shifted the public agenda on that issue.
What about costs? Anyone concerned about that whole controversy?
Well, it's just monumental, and they can't judge the cost. They don't know how they're going to pay for it. They don't know how they're going to ration it. The idea that it's all going to be done with employer mandates and a few taxes on cigarettes is nonsense. But let me take a small issue with Mike for once. And that,
for once in the past 5 minutes.
Yeah, and that is that the Heritage Foundation proposal is not the most right-wing radical proposal. In fact, there is a strong body of opinion, which is, but many Republicans are coming up with. William Kristol started it, Dick Cheney is talking about it, and that says that you don't need a root and branch transformation and rebuilding of the health system, that there's nothing wrong with the system. You make a few reforms, like you do on any kind of legislation, and you don't socialize and nationalize one-seventh the American economy.
No one's suggesting that.
Okay, I'm not changing the subject, but I want to ask you, since you've worked in a White House, Mona, you've worked for First Lady Nancy Reagan, how do you look at this First Lady, and has she done things to help that office, First Lady of the United States of America? Has she changed it?
I think that she has brought her own stamp to it, as they all do, but I don't really see it as an office. It's more something to preside over, but Hillary Clinton has used her position as the wife of the president to become really a cabinet member and to make policy. As such, she should be held accountable the way any other government official or any other politician is held accountable. What I resent about Hillary Clinton's self-presentation is that she comes before the Congress, for example, to describe her health program and says that she is coming as a wife and a mother. No, she isn't. She's coming as a politician who is trying to remake one-seventh of our economy.
Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton, for anybody who's followed their career, were, in fact, a pair. It was two for the price of one. Then, which became controversial in the during the campaign, there was sort of a subterranean approach in the fall of 1992. But there was no question she was going to be central. Mona made the point earlier, and I think validly so. Ronald Reagan ran on a position, a set of programs, came to office, and then enacted that. Bill Clinton did the same thing. He ran on health care. He ran on jobs, health care, and deficit reduction, and he's fulfilling all three promises.
Middle-class tax cut.
Middle-class tax cut was secondary, just like balancing the budget, you recall, Mona, in 1980. but the reality is this about Hillary Rodham Clinton. She has changed the office. And the fact of the matter is, she went before the Congress and she absolutely captivated them. They didn't know how to handle her.
She is not, Bernie, operating as a first lady. Mona's exactly right. She's operating as an illegal cabinet member because she's breaking the the Nepotism Act. I think it's a silly law. It should be repealed, but it's on the books. And what she is doing is that she has got a proposal in there that has made a social issue out of health care when it should be an economic issue.
Let me. I can't even address all the misconceptions Bob spewed out about this health care reform in the past couple of minutes, but so let me just pick one, the question of cost. We spend 14% of our GDP on health care. Under the Clinton plan, it would go up to 17. Without any reform, it would go up to 20. If we can't hold cost to 17%, it's hopeless.
That's the government's numbers.
On that note, we'll be back in a moment.
Ever fall in love so hard it hurt? The memory keeps coming back like a captures all those romantic memories in the rock and roll era. Recapture the magic with 22 fabulous hits from 1959. Only $9.99 on compact disc or cassette. More than one full hour of music. Have the opportunity to audition other great albums. There's no minimum to buy. Satisfaction guarantee. So call now and relive the romance.
To order Rock and Roll 59, use your credit card and call 1-800-592-9400 or send $9.99 for one cassette or one CD plus $3.50 shipping to Rock and Roll 59, Department 1, Richmond, Virginia. Phones open 24 hours.
Crime and violence in America, challenges abroad, and hope in a corner of the world where before 1993, life was dominated by the bullet, the bomb, and the stone. All that when the Year in Review Roundtable returns.
News continues, followed by Sports Tonight, after this local commercial break, next on CNN.
Different kinds of pipes have freeze for different reasons. To protect yours, wrap insulation around exposed pipes. If a hard freeze is forecast, open the doors under sinks and let the hot and cold faucets trickle overnight. Leave the heat on if you're leaving town. Following these steps can get you through cold weather on a high note.
International Airport. Choose from many luxurious accommodations. Then hit the beach for all sorts of water sports. Or go fishing, golfing, shopping, dining, and dancing. South Padre Island is the place for fun. For more information, contact your local travel agent or call 1-800-343-2368.
The world, peace on earth from CNN.
Robert Novak, what are we going to do about the crime and violence in our great country?
Well, this is an issue where the people are united. They want something done. And so the two parties, at least on the surface, are coming closer together. And they don't want psychobabble nostrums. They want more prisons. They want more cops. And more people are connecting the welfare system and the illegitimacy in the lower income brackets with the rise of crime. So I think there is a consensus coming together in America of doing something about it.
We live in a relativistic age. We had decided about 35 years ago that there wasn't any standard of right and wrong that ought to be taught to kids in school, that you could accept illegitimacy as an alternative lifestyle and even promote it by subsidizing it by the welfare system and not bear the consequences. People now recognize, as Bob says, that there are consequences, that there is a moral crisis in this country which is underlying the crime rate, and that we're going to have to get a grip on these very serious underlying problems.
For 20 of the 24 years prior to the election of Bill Clinton, we had Republican conservatives elected in the White House. Now, I don't know when this moral relativism, and I never got the sense that they were saying anything goes or whatever else, and I think that's really...
You missed all that?
I think it's really a slam. It's really a slam upon Ronald Reagan and George Bush and the people, the country who elected them five out of six times. Bernie, two parties had positions cast in concrete, both of which have changed. The Democrats in the past were for gun control when it came to crime, and the Republicans were for capital punishment. And basically, there has been, the Democrats have moved beyond that to a more cops on the street. I think there's a consensus on that. Recognition on prisons and the importance of it, and in keeping bad people out, away from society. So I think, and Republicans now know that capital punishment isn't the answer to all the
problems. What about violence on television, videos?
Violence
in our common culture.
Well, I think there was never a time, even in the 60s, when Mona's fantasy of what a liberal worldview is actually applied, that no one was teaching anyone the difference between right and wrong. I think the big change this year, makes me sound like a hopeless liberal, is that people are finally waking up about gun control.
Oh.
You look around the world, we have the highest crime rate in the advanced world. We also have the longest prison sentences in the advanced world. Now, maybe you want to build more prisons, that's fine. That is not going to solve the problem. The one thing that foreigners who come to our country and who might be watching this show tonight think when they look around and they think, you've got this crazy society where anyone can walk around with a gun.
Yes,
you're right.
Well, you can buy a gun here, but you can buy a gun in Switzerland too. They have every single family has a gun in Switzerland.
You're absolutely wrong. They have to keep them locked up in a closet.
They don't keep them locked. They keep them in their houses.
Apart.
And the fact is, go ahead,
no,
Bob.
Mike, you were right about one thing, that you do sound like a sort of liberal when you talk about gun control.
And are you against it, Bob?
Yeah, gun control has nothing.
Machine guns, how about them?
Gun control has nothing whatever to do with crime prevention. And the cops, the real cops, would tell you that. The politicians, because the police chiefs want to make a deal with the politicians.
The police chiefs, the police union, they're all for gun control.
We are doing this program in Washington right now, which has the strictest gun control laws
in the world.
It's so easy to get a gun, it's ridiculous.
You go to Virginia. That's why it's a
fantasy to think you can remove all guns from this country. It's not possible, so you have to look at other solutions.
It is a very serious difficulty how you get from here to there. There's no denying that. But that doesn't mean that the explosion of guns in this country is not a main part of the problem.
Why is it that when we talk about crime and violence, we never talk about white-collar crime?
Because it's not violent.
It's not. People aren't afraid when they leave their car in the driveway and hear footsteps behind them. They're not afraid that it's some inside trader who's coming after them. That's why. It's much more goes to the heart of...
Bernie, the liberal...
Isn't white-collar crime just as insidious?
No, it isn't.
It isn't
because the liberal...
Wait a minute, let him respond.
It is, quite frankly, just as insidious. But the fear, and Mona's right, the fear of physical invasion of one's very being does not attend that. I mean, there is a sense of outrage, and legitimately so. On the subject of gun control, I'd like to come back to Mr. Novak's point about real cops. Real cops that you talk to want guns out of the hands of 16-year-old kids, of absolute lunatics who are walking around.
So this idea that some macho tattooed
police officer out there saying, bring them all on.
Let me just respond on the question of gun control. That the idea that is going to do anything with this gang warfare, I mean, they're going to get guns from wherever they can, and they're going to be able to do it. There's just no question about it.
So what must law-abiding citizens do?
What must law-abiding citizens do?
Well, for one thing...
Demanding more cops and more prisons.
The one thing that everyone across the political spectrum has agreed on is more cops. I think that's something everyone can support. The question is, how are you going to pay for them?
If you go to the heart of the problem, what we have to do is stop subsidizing family breakdown.
Because
the people who are committing these crimes, Michael, are fatherless young men.
Okay. When we return, charting a course in the brave and chaotic new world.
Under this bright yellow cap, inside this distinctive black bottle, you'll discover gold for your car. Premium quality Phillips 66 Tropartic Motor Oil, engineered to the highest standards of the automotive industry. Now in an environmentally smarter bottle, a bottle made with recycled materials. Look for Tropartic Motor Oil in the black bottle with the yellow cap and discover gold for your car.
The people you've been looking at all believe that a car saved their lives.
I don't say this to many people, but what we do, the job we do...
Okay, guys, listen up.
It's the most important job I can think of.
You've got a flight control check. Lewis and Randall.
I mean, there's no such thing as a B-plus mechanic on this airline.
Let's do it. Let's go.
Everybody knows their job. Everybody's responsible. Anybody, right down to the most junior mechanic, can keep an airplane in this hangar if there's the slightest hint of a problem. You might think, doing a job like this, day in, day out, it'd become routine. You know, just turning wrenches. But every now and then, I just go up and take a walk through the terminal. And right there, right in front of you, you see what's important.
I don't mean this question to sound so simplistic, but is the world changing too fast for the United States government?
Well, Bernie, when Bill Clinton and the Liberal Democrats took over the conduct of foreign policy, what you found is a real irony, because whereas the Democratic Party for the last number of years has been resisting the use of American force and projecting American power around the world, where there really were threats to U.S. interests and to U.S. security, for example, in the Gulf War, what you saw with the Democrats in charge is that U.S. soldiers and U.S. blood and treasure were being put at risk in places where we had no national security concerns at all, like Haiti and Somalia and elsewhere. Somalia was begun by George Bush, but it changed its character under Clinton.
You had a gasp.
I would contend with Mona on all that stuff. Take Bosnia, where Clinton is under very heavy criticism. Trouble is, he's under criticism from opposite points of view. I suspect Bob and Mona would both accuse Clinton of being inept and so on and so forth. Only Bob would say stay out, and Mona, I noticed, left Bosnia off of her list of places where the United States interests should not be involved.
I believe that Bosnia would be a quagmire and not a place we belong.
So we shouldn't do anything, let those people starve?
You see, Bernie, we have...
Yes,
there are limits.
Yes, that's correct.
Bob has the courage of his convictions.
No.
He's wrong, but he has the courage of his convictions.
We should, because
Mona, I don't think she does.
I just said said there are limits to how much the United States can prevent suffering and death in the world.
So in that, those limits,
we cannot,
those do nothing
we cannot
about
what would
the,
you do?
We cannot feed the world. We cannot educate the world. We can't even democratize the world. And I would say that those young soldiers who died that weekend in Somalia did not die in vain. They did not die in vain because they impelled President Clinton to get out of the peacekeeping business. We are out of the peacekeeping business. We are not sending an armored division to Bosnia. We are not even sending a few MPs to Haiti. We are out of that business, and if that's so, their parents can say that maybe they were sent there on a foolish cause, but their sacrifice saved many thousands of more American lives.
For 50 years, Bernie, America's place in the world, by Americans, and by the world, was defined by our opposition to totalitarianism, beginning with Hitler's Germany, all the way through Stalin's Russia to the Soviet dominion, Soviet expansion. And it began that policy of containment, began under a democratic president, was continued by eight successors of both parties. Now it's over. We are feeling our way in the world. We are still uncertain. Bill Clinton, to some degree, is the mirror opposite of George Bush. George Bush, who was schooled and prepared and saw himself as a foreign policy president, was indifferent and unaware domestically what was going on.
Well,
Bill Clinton is a domestic president and has shown a certain unsureness of foot, I think, in dealing internationally.
Well, with your line of thinking, is Bill Clinton going to get the necessary tolerance he needs and patience he needs from the electorate?
There's no consensus.
Oh. From the
There's
Congress.
No consensus on what we ought to do. You can hear it right here. Should we be feeding people in Somalia? I think we will have to answer to our children and our grandchildren for our failure to act in Somalia.
In Bosnia.
I think that really will, it is blood on our hands, and we will look upon it that way next year and the year after.
Can I ask Mike a question?
Sure.
Do you agree with President Clinton's statement that we cannot tolerate a nuclear weapon in North Vietnam? And if so,
North Korea,
I'm sorry. And if so, what do we do about it?
I agree that I would have put it slightly differently. We cannot tolerate a nuclear weapon that North Korea can use. Well, you're in your column, Bob, on this subject, said that they've already got a nuclear weapon, so he's already backed down on his pledge. They've got a nuclear weapon, but it's not worth it anymore.
Oh, that's sophistry. It's not sophistry. Either they have one or they don't have one.
They don't have one that's any good.
The real test for Bill Clinton's conduct of foreign policy is before us now, because the former Soviet Union is now seeming not so friendly.
Okay, I want to drop a name. Bless Aspen. Did he leap? Or was he pushed?
He was pushed, of course, and it was a shame because he was probably the most capable member of the cabinet. He knows he's a giant in defense policy, and he made some mistakes, but probably less mistakes than some of the people at the White House.
Les Aspin became a great hero to Bob about the moment he was pushed.
That's right.
I think.
That's exactly right. I mean, Bob is disingenuous. He's elevated to a new art form. Les Aspin was pushed. Les Aspin had the toughest assignment in the entire Clinton cabinet.
Okay.
Bill Clinton's the first president, Bernie, since Franklin Roosevelt, not to wear the uniform of his country at a time of downsizing of the military, painful dislocation. You needed a defense secretary who had the confidence and a comfort level with the military, which Les Aspin, quite frankly, didn't have. He had great knowledge.
I want to drop one more name before we close out this segment. Warren Christopher is the man skating on thin ice.
Warren Christopher believes in negotiation as the solution to every ill, and negotiation with everyone. And that is not what's called for in this world. The world is far too dangerous, and strength is what's needed.
I more disagree a little bit with my colleague,
yes,
Mona, because I think, first place, she's not skating on thin ice. She's going to be around a long time. And secondly, he may be just the kind of Secretary of State we need right now who is reluctant to send an armored division to Bosnia.
I think Warren Christopher, I think Bob Novak is right. That's right, you know, no adjustment to your set required. I think Bob Novak is right. Warren Christopher is not on thin ice, and I think in the Middle East especially, his skills and artful diplomacy will be helpful.
I think it would have been better off, Clinton would have been better off appointing a Secretary of State who was a strong man with some vision rather than a negotiator.
Who's your candidate?
Okay.
I'll tell you later.
Well, on that note, the wobbly steps toward peace in the Middle East and Russia's winter of discontent when the year in review returns.
stars. A jaguar remains defiantly individual. Because Jaguar has a design philosophy that doesn't change with the wind. For details on the new Jaguar Dream Lease, see your local dealer.
Tylenol? For fever and things, it's great, sure. But headaches? My headaches? It's not always strong enough. So I went and got Excedrin. For that one reason. Excedrin's better than Tylenol at relieving headaches. That's enough of a reason for me. You use what works better, right? Tylenol for some things. But for headaches, Excedrin.
Excedrin, the headache medicine.
Oh, my gosh. That felt good. And here I am in my old house coat.
If our winners look surprised...
It is unreal.
It's because they are.
You have got to be kidding.
Could you come here?
We don't tell them we're coming.
You have got to be kidding.
We just knock on their door.
You have got to be kidding.
It's like a surprise party on your doorstep.
I'm speechless, and I'm not usually speechless.
We're the Prize Patrol from Publishers Clearing House, and we could surprise you with $10 million next month.
Hi, it's Larry King. Join us next week as we revisit some of the year's best one-hour interviews. Jay Leno, First Lady Hillary Rodham Clinton, Michael Jordan, and others on Larry King Live weeknights, 9 Eastern on CNN.
There was a time when perhaps romantically, we used to think of Russia and the song From Russia with love. But nowadays, thoughts about Russia are not about love.
Well, let me make a prediction for 1994 as relates to Russia, which is I think that this man, Zhirinovsky, who's getting all the attention this month at the end of 1993, this is his 15 minutes. He will not be a big story in 1994 because he did not get as many votes. He does not get as many seats in the parliament as everyone was saying. He didn't even get the 80% from the military that CNN exit polls originally said he got. He got 25% from the military itself. He's not that big a deal. He's nothing to be that scared of.
But Michael, what if the economy continues to get worse? Mightn't that help him?
Well, sure. The problem with economic reform, with conversion from any system, certainly communism to capitalism, is that things get worse before they get better. And you have to make this leap. And that's why we should be doing more to aid them.
Now, that isn't what we should be doing. What we should be doing is avoiding the shock therapy solution that we prescribe for them. See, Bernie, what happened was when communism fell in the Soviet Union, instead of businessmen coming in to try to solve their problems, we had Harvard professors. We had Professor Sachs coming in with shock therapy, people who knew nothing whatever about market economics.
Oh,
or
that
how,
is a ridiculous libel on an excellent economist.
Well,
who knows a heck of a lot more about economics than you do.
No, I beg to differ, because what he didn't understand is you cannot take the savings away of the people and say everything you have saved for all your life is finished, and we cannot say that you cannot have economic growth and economic reform without stabilizing the currency. They have done nothing. That's the typical Ivy League type egghead who doesn't understand that the ruble is what's central to Russia.
Rob is trying to prescribe the free lunch for Russia as Reagan prescribed for America, and it certainly won't work there.
Bernie, what we don't know and what that election result made us worry about, what we don't know is how much has 70 years of communism corrupted the Russian soul? How much are these people drawn to authoritarian figures because of the nature of that society over time? We did have, as you put it, fond hopes that they would move toward democracy. It may not be such smooth sailing. They may not want it the way we do.
They are moving toward a democracy, and I think it is painful and it is slow, and there's going to be setbacks, but they are moving. And if someone had sat here 7 years ago and said, we'll be arguing about parliamentary elections and whether when the next national election in what used to be the Soviet Union, we would ask them to go to St. Elizabeth's, where they'd be inducted to the Washington Police Force.
The Middle East.
That's an inside joke.
Is there going to be more peace than war?
Yes, I think that the process has started that will not be stopped, despite the setbacks, despite the battles in Gaza and the West Bank. And I think that it will follow with Syria and the other countries probably next year.
After an hour of disagreeing with Michael, let me say, in the spirit of the season, I agree with him 100% on that. I really believe that only the obscurantists and the extremists on both sides want to kill people instead of stopping the war. I think this is the most positive development of 1993, and there's going to be hard times, but the process can't be reversed.
In the next year, are we going to find that Hafez al-Assad of Syria is going to be on the hot seat?
You've got a bigger troublemaker than Hafez al-Assad over there. Go ahead, Mona.
No, I think Bob is wrong about this, as he usually is about anything that involves Israel. This may be the dawn of peace in our time, but it probably isn't. You are still dealing in the Arab world with a series of regimes and groups that are terrorist in their very nature and that have not a democratic bone in their bodies. And it is clear from just the play out over the last several weeks since that famous handshake on the White House lawn that Yasser Arafat may have come to some sort of new device for dealing with Israel, but that by no means speaks for all Palestinians or all Arabs.
Might I interject that we mustn't forget about the man in Baghdad, Saddam Hussein?
No, your old friend from Baghdad. We can't forget about him, but I couldn't let the moment pass without saying that I do agree with Mr. Novak and Mr. Kinsley that General Rabin, an authentic war hero, is going to be the architect of peace on the part of Israel. And I think Yasser Arafat, and I think that there will be peace with Syria. And I think that it will lead to the further isolation of our old friend in Baghdad.
Mm-hmm. Peace is only gained by secure borders, and you cannot rely on pieces of paper alone for your security.
Moving to Africa.
Between us and Canada.
South Africa.
Well, there I wouldn't be so optimistic, I'm afraid. Certainly the development this year, just this past week, They finally approved the parliament. The white parliament dissolved itself, and a new biracial, multiracial, non-racial, really, parliament, which will be primarily black, will be set up when next May. Mm-hmm. That's a great development. There's obviously reason for pessimism as to whether that will all go peacefully.
The test is going to be whether the African National Congress, and I think it's a great development that's happened there, but the test is going to be whether the African National Congress is going to have the forbearance not to seek revenge, not to confiscate property, to respect the property rights and the political rights of the white minority after they have been persecuted mm-hmm. for decades. It's going to take maybe more character and more decency than is generally found in human beings.
What about forbearance on the part of your favorites, the Buthelezi and the Zulus?
I agree. I think it takes forbearance on all sides and including don't forget the right extremists, right-wing extremists
sure.
can cause a lot of trouble too.
Same kind of forbearance that European settlers exercised on this continent.
Well, there weren't that many Indians.
One quick response to this question, anyone. Is there going to be a resolution of the North Korean crisis?
I wouldn't dare to predict on that one.
I'll make a prediction. I think it's going to stretch out. There's not going to be they're going to try to put in economic sanctions, and that's going to be the leverage that China uses in getting the kind of policies from the United States. So I think it's in China's interest to keep the Korean crisis moving, and we're discussing it a year from now at this time.
Okay.
Margaret Thatcher had a great idea. She said, why don't we just wink at China and say, you do what you think necessary.
Okay. Coming up, this bunch looks into crystal balls to see what's in store for 1994. It's time for predictions, 1994. Robert Novak.
With the economy tailing off at the end of the year, there will be bigger than usual midterm Republican gains in both House and Senate, giving the conservatives effective control ideologically of both chambers.
Michael Kinsley.
My prediction is slightly different from Bob's. Let the good times roll. Economic boom will be the big story of 1994.
And Mona
Charen. Wishful thinking. The Republican who leads the charge against the Clinton health care plan will be the nominee of the Republican Party in 1996. At the moment, it looks like that may be Dick Cheney.
Boy.
Mark Shields.
Wow. There's a 94 to 96, so we can't...
Two for the price of
one. We have to wait till the summer of 96 to see if Mona's 94 prediction was
right. We don't have to invite her back next year, though.
National health care, Bernie, will become the law of the land in 1994. Fulfillment of a promise and the extension of a pledge to all Americans that they will have available to them excellent health care, the kind that Bob Novak has flourished under.
And my prediction is the safest of all kind to make. In 1994, the unexpected will happen. Our thanks to Robert Novak, and to Michael Kinsley, and to Mona Charen, and to Mark Shields.
Thank you
all. The happiest, the warmest, the safest of holidays to all of us. Thank you.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. And for the Year in Review Roundtable, I'm Bernard Shaw in Washington.